Let us commence the lecture on developmental and congenital oral conditions by looking at white sponge nevus. This is a harmless disorder of keratinocyte cellular biology manifesting at the mucosal level and may sometimes be misdiagnosed as any of the oral white lesions simply because of its clinical appearance. Even though the oral mucosa is mostly affected, other mucosal sites like the esophagus, anogenital, laryngeal, and conjunctival surfaces may also be involved, either as a solitary occurrence or in combination. But I must say that most extraoral cases occur together with the oral variant. For instance, buccal mucosal lesions may be observed to extend backwards and down to the esophagus or larynx. So essentially, you are unlikely to find solo extraoral lesions with no oral involvement. It usually is seen at birth and has a varied degree of clinical expression, changing phenotypically over the course of time throughout the development and lifetime of the affected individual. Such changes may be in the form of clinical exacerbations or even remissions. As I mentioned, the buccal mucosa is the most commonly affected intraoral site. This is followed by other non-keratinized areas such as the mucosa of the lips, floor of mouth, ventral tongue surfaces, and the alveolar ridges. It is uncommon on the dorsal tongue, palate, and gingiva, and this is because the disorder predominantly affects non-keratinized and stratified epithelia. Lesions on the alveolar ridges may sometimes be misdiagnosed as benign alveolar ridge keratosis. The disorder is autosomal dominantly inherited and has an irregular degree of familial penetrance, which effectively means that cases may or may not be observed to run in families, and in fact some cases do occur sporadically. The classic presentation is that of a bilateral painless involvement of the cheek mucosa, with similar findings in relatives and immediate family members, though this may not always be the case because of irregular penetrance or sporadic cases. The lesion characteristics may be described as diffuse, soft, and spongy plaques of white mucosal tissue in a somewhat symmetrical distribution. The mucosa appears folded with intervening ridges, corrugations, and furrows that go deep into the plaques and may frequently be inhabited by bacterial and fungal microorganisms, thereby establishing local infection and inflammatory sites, which may manifest in some individuals as pain or as a general sensation of oral dysesthesia, burning mouth sensations basically. For most cases, however, it is completely asymptomatic, benign, and will require no clinical therapeutic intervention. The disorder has no racial or gender predilection, and the female genital mucosa is thought to be the most frequent extraoral site to be affected. This picture is demonstrating the involvement of the mucosal surface of the labia minora. Again, most cases are asymptomatic, often discovered incidentally during a clinic visit for other possibly unrelated reasons. The differential diagnosis for oral presentations might include things like leukoplakia, hereditary benign intraepithelial discoratosis, leukoedema, hyperplastic candidiasis, and other candidosis, and a number of potentially malignant disorders. Aside the histology, which we will discuss in a bit, key features that may help clinically to pick out white sponge nevus from the list are its non-disappearance with the mucosal stretch test, and also that the mucosal plaques are non-scrapable. The pathogenesis begins with germline variations in the genes for some special types of keratins, keratin 4 or keratin 13. The genes for these are located on the long arm of chromosome 12 and 17 respectively. Now, there are at least 20 normal epithelial keratin types, with type 2 keratins 4 and its type 1 counterpart keratin 13 being specifically produced by mucosal keratinocytes of the mouth, nose, esophagus, and anogenital areas. Aberrant versions of these mucosa-specific cytokeratins are responsible for the clinical manifestation of white sponge nevus. These abnormal keratins are unstable, highly fragile, and with a tendency to aggregate intracellularly. Indeed, white sponge nevus is categorized as a keratinocyte fragility syndrome. Note that normal keratins serve as a crucial cytoskeletal structural support for epithelial cells, playing a pivotal role in maintaining epithelial integrity. They may also be involved in the regulation of epithelial differentiation and certain physiologic and immunologic responses. When they become defective in white sponge nevus, the effect is an unbalanced proliferation and differentiation of keratinocytes and an overall loss of epithelial homeostasis, so that even the mildest forms of mechanical stresses become tricky to withstand. In addition, these defective keratins, as you might expect, are not easily ubiquitinated for cellular degradation and tend to condense intracellularly. The variations in these keratin genes may be a result of molecular base pair deletions or point mutations, ultimately leading to a change in substitution of one amino acid for another having different properties, or leading to the introduction of premature stop codons due to an altered reading frame of the coding mRNA transcript. The specific gene defect can be analyzed from PCR and sequencing data as part of a diagnostic workup if necessary. Now, because keratin expression begins at in utero embryonic stages, a significant number of white sponge nevus cases do present at birth, or at least within the first 2 decades of life, being influenced by mechanical stresses like suckling during breastfeeding, introduction of the child to solid foods, and postnatal oral infections. Later on in life, a coarse diet, consumption of hot food, certain oral habits, and even smoking may play a role in clinically facilitating the expression of the lesions. We all know that the oral cavity is a harsh environment, and that even individuals with normal keratin genes still develop areas of epithelial hyperplasia and hyperparakeratosis in response to oral frictional stresses. It is perhaps worth noting or mentioning that epidermal keratins of the skin are typically not affected in white sponge nevus, which means that this disorder does not have cutaneous manifestations. I just wanted to point that out in passing. Alright, the clinical presentation and historical information are quite sufficient enough, so much so that an oral biopsy is not often warranted, and it's only indicated at times when the lesions are difficult to distinguish from other look-alike white disorders, especially those that may be potentially sinister. In that case then, take note that the histopathology of white sponge nevus will be characterized by a benign parakeratotic oral epithelium with marked acanthosis. There may be some degree of inflammation within the subepithelial connective tissue. The peculiar feature, however, is the extensive cytoplasmic vacuolation of keratinocytes within the thickness of the epithelium. These same keratinocytes will demonstrate intense perinuclear eosinophilic condensations made of entangled masses of abnormal keratins, keratins 4 or 13, essentially being a form of this keratosis. Cytopathologic examination, which is in fact what I am showing here, is a good way to confirm the diagnosis. Now, I should emphasize here that the genetic alterations of this disorder often only affect one type of keratin in any one particular individual, so that in a patient with white sponge nevus, the molecular studies usually do not show aberrancy in both types of keratins. This seems to be beneficial since the other unaffected keratin could take responsibility for some of the functional gaps left behind by the aberrant variant. The vacuolation we see here is non-lipidic and due to glycogen accumulation and may be an adaptive physiological response, non-specific to this disorder. You may also refer to them as clear cell changes. Overall, the epithelial changes will be benign with no sign of dysplasia. The benignity of the condition means that treatment is simply conservative and targeted at controlling superimposed infections if they do occur. Controlling these infections with antimicrobials has been reported in a number of cases to also lead to the clinical resolution of the lesions. But then, most of these were temporary measures as there was recurrence following cessation of the drugs. This recurrence is not unexpected because 1. The disorder is genetic, and 2. The oral cavity will always remain harsh and challenging the already fragile keratinocytes with functional mechanical stresses. The ultimate outcome is a compensatory overexuberant hyperkeratosis characteristic of the condition. In fact, it is quite possible that cases that have supposedly resolved with antibiotics may have been completely different unrelated pathologies misdiagnosed as white sponge nevus. With that said, current scientific innovations may provide options of gene-based therapies for this condition, and such therapies may prove to be potentially curative.